is Tuesday, August the 3rd. It's a little after 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I'm speaking with H. Randolph Holder of Athens, Georgia. And I've got to take the lens cap off, so it's a good thing I announced the date and time. And Mr. Holder, I'm wondering if you would share with us a little of your experience during the World War II era.
Yes, I had already graduated from college with 2 degrees in Spanish and psychology, and had intended to go to graduate school and then teach. Unfortunately, the war came in there before I could complete those plans. So I was already 24 years old when I was drafted. And I was number 112 in my community, and they took 675 right off the bat. And I was the only college graduate that didn't have enough sense to find some way to get out of it for a while and put off my getting in. They sent me a letter that said, "Report or else," is what it amounted to. And they said, "Greetings, but if you don't report, then you go to jail." So I went. And I was a very unhappy camper. I was not a happy camper because, number one, the war had not started anywhere. We weren't involved in it in 1939, even though that was when Poland was invaded by the Germans. It seemed so far away, and I was born in Illinois, 1,500 miles from top to bottom and 3,000 miles from anything in either direction. So we were more or less isolated, and it didn't occur to me that we'd get into a war. But the idea was we'd go and be trained for 12 months and then return to civilian life. My 12 months turned into 5 years, plus another 22 in the reserves, and so it was a long haul. But they first interviewed us. There were 5 people on the draft board, and they interviewed us and in a big National Guard armory building. And when they called my name, I dragged my right leg all the way across to the table just to give them something to think about. And they were aghast at this crippled fellow who was going to go into the army. But of course, I was in good shape. And I noticed a marked difference in treatment of people. When before I signed the thing saying that I was in the army, say, "Mr. Holder, step over here," and "Mr. Holder, step over here" for the physical. But when I got through with that and signed the papers, downstairs, just down a flight of stairs, there was a sergeant down there hollering, "Get your so-and-so down here and fall in." So they immediately made a difference in the attitudes with which they taught you. I took quite a few classes, and it was the first time in my life I ever had thought of anybody being illiterate. It had never occurred to me that everybody couldn't read and write. We were taking some of these tests, and this nice kid next to me said, "What does this mean?" So I read him the question, and he stumbled around a bit and tried to answer, and after a while he thought he had it, and then he asked me, "What does this mean?" He couldn't read the questions in the test, and so I told him, you know, that I didn't have time enough to do his work for him. So, but it was really shocking to me to find somebody who couldn't read and write. When I went on to camp, finally got down to Fort Knox, Kentucky, and I was in replacement training camp, and still being recalcitrant soldier, I would volunteer to do work like putting stones down in the red clay mud in Kentucky and making walks around the camp rather than go out and do exercises with the rest of the company. Finally, I decided that this was grossly stupid, and perhaps we might be in there longer than a year. And so I knew I didn't want to stay a private for a whole year because privates did all the work and the officers, of course, did fewer jobs. So I had gone to a school, Augustana College, so I didn't have to take ROTC. I didn't care much for being ordered around left face, right face, forward march. And so, but I had been in Boy Scouts, and so I knew all of the basic stuff from Boy Scouts, and that put me in very good stead. We went down, and the first time they were trying to develop leadership in those early days, too. I started going out on these walks and so forth, and hikes. But I found out that I was, and they allowed me to give some commands. Having been used to this already from the Boy Scouts, and I have a very loud voice, when I had a company attend, whoop, the whole damn battalion went to attention. Everybody's picking up their ears, who is that fellow with a loud voice? Well, eventually, I took a class in first aid, and I was in didn't know anything about first aid. He'd say, the book says, and then he would read from the book. I had been teaching first aid for the American Red Cross for 6 or 7 years, and so I went down to the company orderly room and did what no good soldier was supposed to do. I volunteered. And I said, I want to see the company commander. And this old mean old sergeant said, now, did you hear that, Captain? What do you want? I said, well, I volunteered to teach first aid. I said, Lieutenant Hill is a nice man, but he doesn't know a damn thing about what he's doing. And I've been teaching it for the Red Cross. So I got in to see the captain. And next day, Private Holder, teaching a class in first aid, which happened to be the old pressure, prone pressure method, the Schaefer prone pressure method. And I had 240 men out there, 120 pairs on their shoulder halves, and they had this raised platform about as high as this table where you could get up so everybody could see you and hear you. And I was doing these exercises, and I saw an officer walking around in back of the group, but I had way too much to do to mess around or even think about it. When I was through with that class, I heard over the loudspeaker system a Private Holder report to the company orderly room. Went down and got in to see the captain. He said, I really liked what I had to hear today. That was a battalion commander out there watching you. And he said, my God, where did you get this guy? So he said, could you teach the nomenclature of a 25-millimeter gun? And I said, I haven't seen a pistol yet. He said, well, if I gave you a book, could you do it? Well, earlier I'd gone down and said that I understood that there were books to tell you how to be a soldier. And they gave me half a dozen of them, including the basic manual. And so I said, yeah. So we had the 75-millimeter gun there, and I was telling them, this is the equilibrator, this is the tube, the velocity, and all that sort of a thing. And the same guy was walking around in the background, because you do that once and you got it memorized anyhow. So I got another call to the orderly room and another compliment. And then when they asked for people to go into OCS, the Officer's Candidate School, two other people in my company there and I were placed in there, and he gave us promotions to corporal, so we'd have more than the $21 a month. We're now making $54 a month.
Are you moving around as well?
No, just staying in that same company right then.
And that's Fort Knox?
Yeah, Fort Knox. We were still at Fort Knox in the replacement training center, or the training center there. So as soon as we got through with that group, we were kept on to be teachers. But that was when they called for a quick class in OCS, because so many people had taken OCS and had dropped out because they couldn't make the grade. And so I was in the third OCS class. There were only 60 of us. And that many had dropped out of the first two. So I graduated in the top five, and so I got a cavalry commission and was assigned to the 1st Armored Division, and which was located on a post. I kept that instead of a second lieutenant, a second Armored Division, because by that time I had married a Louisville girl, Clementi Lacey Baker, and so I wanted to stay in Kentucky.
So how did you meet your wife?
I met her, we always say she was an Army camp pickup. I met her at a dance on the post. We had the usual dances where they'd have 50 girls and 500 men. Didn't really interest me much, but this was what they call the Viennese ball. And there was one woman for every soldier. And they wore long dresses, and of course we just had a uniform on. And my wife is a rather spontaneous person. She got off the bus just as soon as it stopped in front of the place, and she was wearing a beautiful, she's a tall brunette. She was wearing an orange evening dress, and she charged out ahead. Nobody else after her. Just she walked down along, of course, whistling and all that was going on. But she caught my eye, of course, as she was going in. So at any rate, why then? These old ladies, about 40 years old, which we thought considered very old in those days, they were the chaperones, and they were taking us in to introduce us to our dates. And they would bring us in two at a time, and we would sit down at a table with the girls. Well, when my chaperone was going to take another fella and myself, she was walking down here. I'm looking all over for that orange dress, so I spotted it over on the left, and I did a left oblique and went over there and sat down. I don't know what that poor... She only ended up with one at the table she introduced. So I introduced myself and went on from there. On our fifth date, I asked Mary to marry me. By this time, we had gone swimming together. We had talked about Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts. She was a big Girl Scout operator. And we had gone canoeing. We knew we liked the same type of things. And so we were married after I got out of OCS. But when she met me, I was a corporal. well, really a private, I guess. I hadn't got, received my promotion yet. But anyhow, that's how we met. So right after I got out of OCS, we had a brief honeymoon on Saturday and a Sunday, and I had to be back at the post Monday morning at 5. And I got into Company D, 1st Armored Regiment, 1st Armored Division, in the tanks. And the trouble of it was the tanks were no good because they were from World War I, you know, a lot of them. Very, very poor tanks. And sometimes we had, out of 17 tanks, we'd only get two we could start. And then we would put a chain on the others and pull them around until they got started on any kind of cold weather. So it was not very good equipment we had. Well, finally, we were moved to the coast, and we had, to make a long story short, we were moved to the coast, and our company was left behind to transfer all the wheeled vehicles to the New York Navy Pier where they were loaded on ships. And we finally made North Ireland. We came in at Belfast. And this is the first time we saw, well, we had seen a little bit of the war before that, because when we left New York Navy Pier, we went through the Cape Cod Canal, and the German U-boats sunk three of our ships right after we got through the Cape Canal. They were working on our shores in 1942 when I went overseas. And they were right outside. Then we went up to Halifax, got in a big convoy, and came over to the British Isles where we were stationed in North Ireland for a while. We went from North Ireland to make the landing in North Africa in November 42. Yes. And so we went down there.
Did you have any time in Ireland then between those 2 days?
Yes, we had quite a bit of time there, several months, in fact. We went over in June and we didn't leave until November. And by that time we had left from North Ireland. We made a practice landing in New Brighton Beach and across the Irish Sea, and we were stationed in England for a couple of months before we went over. And we left from the port there at the Liverpool to go with the convoy that was making the landing in North Africa. So we landed at Oran, only I came in on the second day and I never heard a shot fired in anger. The 6th Infantry had to take the port, and that at that time the port people were still with the non-De Gaulle people, so therefore they fought us when we made the landing there. And we had about 240 casualties in the 6th Armored Infantry. But as I said, I came in the next day. Quite frankly, I was a big arrowhead, you know, on your badges that you give arrowhead. Anybody that comes in the first 2 or 3 days apparently gets a landing badge, but I didn't really earn mine. I just watched.
He landed upon Oran?
Yeah, at Oran in North Africa, in Oran, Nigeria.
And had a day of heavy casualties?
Well, the day before was had heavy casualties with the infantry, but we never had any fighting when we went in. We just got in, finally got our tanks. There was such a bad storm coming down from England to make that invasion in North Africa that many of our ships had to turn around and go back to port. And so our tanks didn't arrive until some weeks after we made the landing in Oran. Well, they finally got there, then we put them together and we were ready to do whatever needed to be done. We were then transshipped to make an encircling movement, and we came in at Philippeville, Algeria, and from then on into Tunisia. From there, and that's of course then when the real stuff started. But quite frankly, I was interested to know that I was able to use my Spanish at Oran in that area there, and quite a lot of people spoke Spanish and French, but not many of them spoke English. And so something that I learned in college did do me some good, which I was very interested to remember. When we came into Tunisia, we were finally on the desert there, and we were doing mostly backup work at the time. Rommel's Africa Corps was being forced back from Gaza, by Montgomery's, anyhow, pushing them back. And we were ostensibly just supposed to sit and make sure they didn't come too far inland, but stayed fairly close to the coast. Unfortunately, we had many, many senior officers who did know nothing about tactics. Many of them knew nothing at all about tank tactics. We had one brigadier in that whole area who knew anything about tank tactics. And of course, Patton with the 2nd Armored Division was over at Casablanca. He hadn't come in there yet. So he and the other officer really understood what tanks could do. And so therefore we were being moved. I was even attached, my platoon was even attached to the French Foreign Legion for 2 weeks. I mean, they didn't know anything about what they were doing. And they had us under command of an English general. We were only under command of an American general for 1 day before they broke our first armored division up. And that's supposed to be used as a heavy unit. A whole armored division is a pretty heavy unit. Instead, they were pooping us away a battalion or a company or a platoon at a time. So finally, in February 19th or 18th, we heard a big battle on the radio. We were up in the mountains at Oselsha. And that was, we were just sitting there, a whole battalion of tanks, just sitting there, and had not been ordered to do anything except just wait. Apparently, they forgot where we were. Finally, we heard that all the shooting and so forth going on, and we were getting our Tokuses licked down on the deck. We could tell that from the radio transmissions that we were listening to on our tanks. And a Jeep came by with some senior officers in it and said, "What are you doing here?" "Well, you know, our battalion commander said this is where we're supposed to be." "No, there's something wrong. So we got orders the next day. They took off. We got orders the next day to come on down. So we, in front of all the German operation points where they could see it, we went down, one battalion of tanks, 54 tanks, that's all there were, and got down near Sidi Bouzid, which was a Tunisian town. And we were sent in the next day to do one battalion tank attack on the German forces, and it would come through an area that the British intelligence had said that they could not come through that pass, but they did. And so our orders that day read, when we made an attack, this is, we had other small skirmishes and so forth and air attacks before this, but this was the first big battle. And we had our orders to sweep the enemy from the valley. Well, unfortunately, the enemy was then the 10th, 15th, and 21st Panzer Divisions, and they were hard to sweep with 54 tanks. In fact, the area where we were attacked three battalions head-on, they had a battalion on each of our flanks. So we made this headlong attack, which was a dumb thing to do. We could have fought a delaying action and done what we should have done. But we made this head-on attack, and at the end of a 6.5-7 hour firefight, I had just my own tank left, and my best friend's tank, it was another officer just up the little wadi from us, about a quarter of a mile. All the other tanks had been knocked out or destroyed. And I counted, slightly before that time, I counted, we had 27 German tanks closing in on our rear. So what they had done, that classic pincer movement is all it was, and we just were pushed into that by some senior officer who didn't know what he was doing. Anyhow, they sent back three generals after that, including a lieutenant general who was remarked about in the movie Patton. He was a corps commander, and they sent him back. Our division commander got the blame for something he had nothing to do with, and the only guy that knew anything about tanks, they sent him back too, which was dumb. But at any rate, we were surrounded, and we were ordered, our last order was, I'd already seen my tank, my company commander go up in flames, and I knew that a couple of people had gotten out of his tank. But we were ordered to counterattack to the rear. So my best friend said, "Well, I'll come on down and we'll go out together." So he came to start coming down the wadi. I noticed we had a wounded man over there, and another one of his buddies was staying with him. So I got out of the tank and we got him back into our tank turret, so we gave five people in the turret instead of three. We were a little crowded because we couldn't leave anybody out there on the field. So we started out together, but we didn't get very far because the 88s were hitting us from behind, and we had all in front of us, no way possible to break out, really. We just had to go ahead and try because that was the only thing we had left to do. Almost immediately, came through the back armor plate, an inch and a half of armor, through the 401 engine, under all the turret stuff, which was lucky it went under the turret instead of through the turret. And it was an 88, obviously. It went through my assistant tank drive, almost out the front end of the tank, through all those giant gears, went all the way through that and poked out about that far in the front. Well, it caught on fire immediately. They told us back in camp that if your tank is knocked out, fight them like a fort. This turned out to be arrant nonsense, because with 250 gallons of high octane fuel, 56 gallons of oil, and all that high caliber and ammunition in there, it just went up in a hurry. It caught fire immediately. So my guys pushed me out, and I was counting them to try to keep track of where they were, and of course we could bring no weapons with us. My submachine gun had a bracket that had been put in upside down by some defense worker, and it was lucky for me, because if I take my gun out, I would have had to shoot it at somebody eventually and gotten killed. But as it was, I couldn't get out with anything except my first aid pack. Even my knife fell off my out of my scabbard. So I sent off everybody who could go except the wounded man. I sent him off under command of a corporal to try to get out the back. And my driver had been the last one out of the tank, so he said that he couldn't get the assistant driver out. So I started in under the assistant, under the tank from the start to try to get him out of the escape hatches in the bottom of all tanks. And he, despite the fact he was out of his head, had, because he'd done it so many times in practice, had come out the escape hatch when he couldn't do it before that, even with help. So he got out there, and I dragged him out. He died in my arms. I had his blood all over me, and never did come out of my clothes. But at any rate, I told the other guy who just had a little flesh wound that we'd be there, and then I'd get him back after dark, because anywhere we played dead. So we played dead. They came through in wheeled vehicles, armored vehicles, wheeled vehicles, and then in infantry teams of 3 to 5 people, submachine guns and rifles, and they turned over all of us dead bodies. Well, of course, I felt kind of stupid. I didn't even have a scratch. But when I stood up, I said, I'm an officer, and I want these men taken care of. Smartest thing I ever said, they thought they had a general. Of course, they didn't know our markings any more than we knew theirs. And it was a very, very interesting time. They sent some people over to take care of our men immediately, verified the fact that one had died and the other one just had a flesh wound. And my one had a flesh wound was talking to the guy in German. And his name was Heinrichs. Our corporal's name was Heinrichs. But I didn't know he could speak German. He never told anybody he could. He just spoke that all the time at his home in Iowa where he had been, which was interesting to me. He should have been in another unit instead of in a tank. He'd be there in the intelligence where he could do some good. But anyhow, they came by, and they sent a motorcycle out to pick me up. I never walked a step, not a step. We got in, they put blankets all around me, started back in the time, into the town, which was about a half a mile to three-quarters of a mile away across the desert. And it was very interesting because we got stuck in the sand. Well, in the American Army, the officers would get out and push just like everybody else. I started to get up and get out. No, 99 Zetsons, that's the thing. So they pushed and got on through, and then they brought me back to a headquarters sort of building. And quite frankly, they just stood me there with a guard. And I saw all these Mark VI Tiger tanks coming by, giant thing. We never had a tank as good as the Germans until 15 years after the war, 10 or 15 years after the war. And even then, the muzzle velocity of our guns never did get to the 88 stage. So we were outgunned and out-tanked and everything else, and out-commanded, quite frankly. They attributed the loss to the greenness of the troops. There isn't any greenness in troops, because you're just shooting right in there and everything you see. What comes in is green leadership. Tactics are where you fall down and that type of thing. So basically, the men were not to blame. I lost half of my men dead in just that one battle.
Sounds as if you had a sort of grudging respect for Rommel.
He was very good, and he's on the same level as Patton. And I always wished that I'd been with Patton, because no matter what he did, he always sent in enough to get the job done. Even though it'd be different, attacks are not nice things to think about, because somebody's going to get killed. But basically, Patton always used the armor the way it should be, in immense pushes. With a lot of push and get through, and then go in back of the lines and just cut everything down. He was a good officer. But anyhow, that they put me back in that sidecar, took me to a downtown area, and I thought, well, now they're really going to try the rough stuff, because we'd had some talk about how what you're supposed to do, name, rank, and serial number, and all that, and the way that you try to get information from you. So I backed over in the corner, and a couple of big Germans came over there and said, are you from those tanks out there? And I said, I can't say. And they said, humph, can't say. And they went on away. So they never tried anything rough. And so then they put me back in the sidecar again, took me back to a headquarters that were pretty far in back of the line. I was keeping good track of where we were because I knew I could get back to our lines if I had to after dark. I mean, when the dark really settled in. But I never had a chance to get away there. They took me into a brightly lighted tent. And the Germans, by the way, drove with their headlights on all the time. We were using blackout lights, little teeny V-shaped things, diamond-shaped things, and they never had to worry about air support. We never had any air support. There was no air support at all in the North African campaign, none at all. And, well, they might have got a little bit farther toward the end, because this was on February 19th that I was captured.
On 43?
1943, yeah. And so we had come all the way over from Oran, which is a couple thousand miles anyhow. But at any rate, I've forgotten where we were right now.
You'd been taken from a sidecar.
Oh, yeah, now we're in the big tent. Yeah. The Zonderfuhrer came over, and he's going to question me. He said, I gave my name, rank, and serial number. And then he said, you know, we're going to have to look at your pockets one way or the other. You're going to turn them out. So I did. We had even the labels on our clothing had been taken off, so nobody didn't know where we bought our clothing. Stupid stuff that really doesn't make any difference. In the end, we found out what was really good information and what wasn't. But they asked me about this. And then he said, I'm going to have to question. I said, fine. Every time he asked me a question, I ask him a question. What are you doing down here fighting us in the desert? It's a good idea. Why are you guys down here fighting us in the desert? Well, the Poles attack our frontier. And I laughed. I said, this is one hell of a contract. You're 3,500 miles from Poland. And then he went on. He finally asked me, he said, do you speak any other languages but German? And I said, yeah, Spanish. I mean, except Spanish. Question me in Spanish. I mean, just polite stuff, and I answered him back politely. Now he said, you'll have time to learn German. Well, I said, I wouldn't be too sure about that, because I don't think we're going to be here long. And so we argued about the war, who was winning the war. And unfortunately, he was right. It was another 2 years before I got away, before I finally escaped. But I was in first. We didn't have any water or food out there for a couple of days. And the Germans who were in charge of our little, to get back still further, they, after they said, well, they apologized for not having facilities, you know, to help us, it was a stupid course, put me on a desert out there in an area ringed by machine guns. And about 11 o'clock that night, a rumble came in. Here came the trucks with the rest of my battalion, who weren't dead, the ones that are still alive, including my best friend, which was very nice.
You know. What was his name?
His name was George L. Durgan, and he's from New Jersey and now lives in California. We see him a couple times a year. We write frequently, telephone frequently. We shared everything for 3 years, including clothing, food, and everything. And so we are best friends I have. And so I was always cold-natured. I had short underwear on, long underwear on, the woolen trousers and shirt, the tank gun suit, overalls and jacket, and three sweaters and two pairs of socks when I got captured.
In the desert.
It was cold as heck, you know. And my friend, he was smart. He didn't get down to fighting stuff, so he just had his woolens on, nothing else. Well, boy, in the desert at night, it's cold as hell, so we were sleeping like this. I gave him a couple of my sweaters, of course, obviously. I mean, he needed them worse than I did, and we would sleep like this and then change so that the one on the outside would be on the inside there once in a while in a big, long line. We went on from there. We finally moved over to Sfax, which is closer to the sea in Tunisia, and we got our first food there.
What's the name of the earlier town?
It was Sidi Bouzid, Sidibouzid, Sidi Bouzid. Arab town. And Sfax was the biggest. It was a city. And we went over there, and they gave us a can of meat for 15 people. It was about the size of a can of pork and beans. And my friend is a very careful guy. We had a knife. and he cut it into 15 pieces, and then I sliced it. And we made our reputation because we were so careful that everything was done evenly, so everybody got the right amount, and if it was a little shaved, we took it ourselves. And so we were the food dividers wherever we went from then on, with whatever group we were with, because they trusted us. But we finally, well, they put us in a truck to get us there. It was so crowded, we couldn't sit down if we were standing up, and couldn't get up if you were sitting down. But it was only a couple hours ride. And then we finally brought up to Tunis. And we were placed in the schoolyard there, and then we were further interrogated and searched. And while I was there, being interrogated again, once again, they told me my platoon, my best friend, and all this sort of stuff, which I told them, said, you know, if you know all that, that's a hell of a lot more than I do. So we just didn't. Anyhow, I had a little watch fob type of calendar, 5-year calendar, with a little knife on one side and a fingernail file on the other. And this lieutenant who was questioning me kept it after I'd shown it or put it out on the table with all my other stuff. So when it got out, the German captain asked, has anybody lost anything that they shouldn't have, they thought they shouldn't have taken away from it? I said, yeah. Told him about it. 5 minutes later, came back out and gave it to him. They were very, very careful, the Germans were, to do everything according to the Geneva Convention. I have no complaints with the Germans whatsoever. Food was bad.
Food was bad. That was that they wouldn't take it, they wouldn't break the Geneva Convention in your case.
I don't think they broke the Geneva Convention in any case, except it would be some wild bugger out, just like we had, because when we made the crossing over from Sicily to Italy, we were forced back off that beach there. And the people in the 3rd Infantry Division told me they mowed down several hundred Germans who were prisoners of war there. They did it themselves. And that's when things began to get bad. Then they began to retaliate for this and that. And you'd get some wild GI, and the first thing you know, he'd shoot up a group. I never witnessed it, but I knew it happened. So, I mean, they were, as far as we were concerned, we were more like the Germans, talking about the people and or the soldiers, than our allies. Very often. I felt a kinship there, even though I'm part German, I'm part Spanish, and English, and Scotch, and French, so and Irish. We just felt they were fair. I have to say that. I saw a German slap one of our officers one time, but I would hit him myself. He blew cigarette smoke, and this German was sort of shrieking at him, still staying away from him. But he's telling me he shouldn't be smoking while his superior officer is standing right there, you know. And he shouldn't have been, because the Articles of War say, you know, everybody, if they're a superior officer, you salute them, and they salute you back. But, of course, some people are hard enough headed, they got in trouble that way, they didn't want to do it. And never let your hate get in charge of your mind. A lot of people got killed in the war because they hated something suddenly and made dashes they should never have done. You need to always keep your mind about you. Anyhow, this guy went right in the German officer's face, and he hit him upside down. Hurt him. Anyhow, that's the only time I ever saw anything out of the way.
I think you were speaking about the food in the prison.
We got 800 calories a day, hot water for breakfast, a slice of black bread thoroughly laced with sawdust at lunch, along with a cup of dehydrated cabbage soup for lunch. For supper, 2 small black spotted potatoes or a cow turnip, one of those orange things full of wood, squish out the stuff to do it. once a week we'd get a tablespoon full of margarine. We'd sometimes get a piece of sausage once a week, a tablespoon full of beet sugar, and beet jam, and that was it. About 800 calories a day. It was supposed to be 1.5 ounces of meat before boning and cooking. And that isn't much. What it does, it just barely gives the water some taste, as far as soup is concerned. And sometimes we each table, there were some tables, 6, 8, and 10 people at a table, we'd have a little garden, and we'd plant onions and tomatoes, and stuff like that in the garden, and we'd use those for our mess too. So we got a little bit more.
I don't think we've gotten you from North Africa to prison camp.
Yeah. We were in Tunis, they flew us out into Italy, and landed in Naples. They flew us in B-52 airplanes with tri-motors, like the old Ford tri-motors. And those old wings out there just going like this. I mean, it was pretty rickety. When we took off from Tunis, a 16-year-old kid looked at me like, I mean, I hope he was 16, and he had at least 16. He went up, and he's a pilot to this thing. And there's 16 of us in this plane, and just sitting on the floor because they didn't have any seats. It was just purely cargo. Nothing happened. Took a ball peen hammer, walked back smiling, you know, boom, boom, in the back someplace. And it came back in smiling again, you know, revved it up and took on off without warming the engines up or anything. Told us there was one German sergeant in the body of the plane with us, and he said, if we're attacked, you take these machine guns at you. Of course, we just laughed him out of the place. Our people were not attacking any of our planes coming back from Africa because they thought we would be in it. They would use them for prisoners of war. So we didn't know that, so we were a little nervous. When we landed at Naples, the Italians greeted us with rotten fruit and bottles and rocks because there had been our bomb in the ports there, you know, like nobody's business. We went to Capua, which was our first prison camp. It was outdoors, all no buildings at all. Well, one building, small one, in which we cooked. Well, I say cooked. We had a fire and heated water. And also they gave us there the stems of cabbage and cauliflower, but they never gave us the heads, just the stems. And it was very difficult to keep a fire going. They didn't have any tools. They had one axe and some splitting material. Terrible wood. And very difficult to do. We had to put six people on that all the time. My best friend and I and one other were mess officers there, for what it's worth. We didn't have anything to distribute much except one cup of that stuff every night. And about a 6-ounce roll of bread, like a bun, like a hamburger bun, only hard bread. That was supposed to get one per man. Unfortunately, they keep putting 50 to 100 new people in the camp every day, so we always run out by the end. What we would do when we got down to the end, we would see how many we had left and divide them in two, take these people's names so that they would not be shorted the next time, to try to keep it going round and round. We had to put guards on the carts bringing in the food and to make sure the Italians didn't cheat us. Now they were. They would lie, cheat and steal. No mistreatment so much, but I mean, any way to make something on the side, they'd do. And so we had to keep them from cheating us, keep our own guys from stealing it, and make sure it was evenly distributed. When we left there, we were moved up in Germany. We went down to the train the way we were, and as we went out, we were given a red box of food. It was British this time. So every two people had a food box. Well, there would be captains with privates and privates with sergeants and sergeants with lieutenants and divided up that way. When we got down to the rail yards, there was one car with seats in it. The rest were box cars, were freight cars. So we were, the three of us, first lieutenant, two second lieutenants, we were with the staff because we'd been handling all of the mess arrangements. And our battalion commander was the senior American officer, so he depended on us. Anyhow, we got down there, and the captain said, "Colonel, it looks as if there's only one car with seats in it. Maybe we ought to go in by rank." And I said, "If we do that, we're going to screw up the food system completely because we got officers of all ranks eating together with the enlistment and so forth. We'll go in as we are." My friend and I went in, and we all sat down like this so that the people, the majors and the colonels and the captains going by the second lieutenants in the car, just in case someone changes his mind and pull a rank. So that's the first time I ever had rank has its privileges, and it's the first time I ever beat it. But it worked out pretty well. We got up to our next camp, which was at Moosburg near Munich. Moosburg was a big, it had thousands in there. I don't know how many thousands, 2,000 or 3,000 prisoners.
And what season is it? What's the weather like?
Well, it was still February and March, yeah. And so in Italy, it was cold as hell. Boy, it comes down off those Apennine Mountains, you know, the ones that go down, and the wind blows off of those, and it is cold. So we about froze in Italy. When we went through the Brenner Pass, it was a blizzard. When we got into Germany, still snow on the ground, of course. And so we got to Moosburg, and they had a big, trading area there that at 2 o'clock every afternoon, everybody had something to go in there. And it was like a market, you know, and trade stuff back and forth. And I had saved two $1 bills, American, by putting it in my shoe. And I found two American toothbrushes. I don't know how they ever got there, but some guy was selling them, so we bought those. And George and I had good toothbrushes the whole time. That was pretty good. Most important, we were eating out of tin cans and had carved ourselves wooden spoons. Just pieces of junk in that area. So after we'd been there, well, that was sort of interesting. We made friends with some Yugoslavs. They were from Mikhailovich, Yugoslavs. They weren't with Tito. They were more aligned.
Do you recall whether they would be Croats or Bosnian Muslims?
I think, no, they weren't Muslims. They were Croats, I'm sure, yeah. Because I found something else interesting. Some of them spoke excellent Spanish. Why? Because of the Spanish Inquisition, they had fled Spain and had come all the way over to Yugoslavia. So they're still speaking their mother tongue, and Yugoslavian also, which was very interesting. Anyhow, my friend and I played chess with them and card games and so forth, because they were pretty well set. They'd been there some time. And then we'd stay until after the curfew at night, which was 9 o'clock, everybody in the barracks. And this big camp, we'd wait until the police dogs and the guards would get up at one end of the street, and then we'd run like hell to get into our barracks before those dogs could catch us, get in there, because they were mean buggers. And we'd get in, shut the door, and sometimes we'd be close enough that you could hear the dogs bouncing against the outside. I mean, so we had a little bit of fun at the same time, even though we were a little dangerous. Then they moved us up to by train. This time we were all in seating cars, third class, very hard wooden seats. We moved up there from Mosseberg to Rothenburg an der Fulda, not Rothenburg, the Alte Stadt, not the old city, but it looked old to us, obviously, you know, with that old construction with the timbers going around, you know, and filled in with the concrete or whatever it is they put on them, plaster. But we were stationed there with the British and the Anzacs. They had a big camp there, I wrote. And it was in an old girls' school, which was used to film a German film that had showed the glories of the Third Reich. Medkin in uniform. Girls in uniform. And all the showers were about this high, you know. And
From each camp to camp, were you moved by train?
Yeah, that was it, yeah.
Boxcars, the same?
No, that was it. We were in seated cars the rest of the time, excepting just that one trip from Italy into Germany, which was pretty good, I thought. I mean, because they put us in boxcars. They could do whatever they wanted to with you, because there was no way you could get out of it, but they didn't do that. In that camp, though, we learned all the escape techniques. They had a tunnel 280 feet long, showed us how to make the air conditioning system with cans put together, you know, and a turning back here to get the air up into the end of the tunnel. They even had electric lights in that bugger. And what they would do, they would dig, and every cubic yard of dirt you take out weighs a ton. So they'd move it out in Red Cross boxes.
And the British, are who's showing you these?
Yeah, British and the Anzacs. They had been captured in Crete, and that far along ago, Crete and Dieppe and some of the ones, the big one, where they almost got run back in the sea. Where they, all right, in the, well, anyhow, in those early battles. And so they would say, okay, now, they would watch the German guards on the outside, so they'd be away from where there'd be any noise. And they'd pass those Red Cross boxes full of dirt up here, and then they would dump them in between the walls of this heavy, heavy wall school. Bricks. And like in a modern building, it'd be a period here of no air. I mean, just air. And then it'd be stone. And then on the outside, that stucco. Well, they'd dump it down into the in-between there. And so that's where they were putting the dirt. And the camp was rather small. I'd say it was only about 100 yards by 100 yards. It wasn't very big. And so they had to be careful how they did this. And in their digging, they had to say, dig. And then they'd dig while the guard would be down here, because otherwise you could hear them through the earth, you know, up above. To put in there and shore them up, we used bed slats. We were on wooden beds with wooden slats 4 to 6 inches wide across here. And they would disappear at a hell of a rate. And of course, you'd take as few out of each bed as you possibly could, because pretty soon you're sleeping on three or four. It's not very comfortable. What you had in there then was just straw mattresses. Straw. I mean, they're just straw sacks, is what it was. And so that's what you slept on. But we learned all that technique, how to make escape clothing. We had maps that we captured, covered, and all that. And they told us all about how to do different things. We found a great affinity for the Anzacs, who were more American than anybody else. I mean, more like us.
Can you tell about Anzacs? I don't know the term.
Australian New Zealand Corps, Anzacs, Australian New Zealand.
Thank you.
Yeah. And we were there quite a long time, and then we moved up into Holland, I mean into Poland, just south of Danzig, about 110 miles south of Danzig, in a city the Germans called Altbergund, which we call Schuben. The Polish called it Schuben, which is just south of Bromberg, and which... I should remember the Polish name for that, but I don't. At any rate, we were up 100 miles from the North Sea in the cold. Very short summers, I can tell you that right now. I was cold. We had stoves, which were not iron or steel. They were ceramic, where you put a little block of coal down here and it goes like this. Well, any time you could put against a stove, which wouldn't, you'd never get burned that hot, and then go, oh, see your breath in the room. So it was really cold. And they had two giant fences there. They had really some to keep you in. Two giant 15-foot-high fences about 15 feet apart at the bottom, filled with coiled wire in the bottom. On the inside of that, a 10 to 15-foot strip of a plowed, raked, and kept even with one strand of wire on the inside, which said, if you cross this line, you will be shot, period. We did get some playground equipment from the YMCA. And so if a ball ever went over in there, you'd have to say, hey, guard, and then he'd have to nod, and then they'd let you go over and pick it out. But then you had to rake over it again, just like a green, just like a trap in playing golf. And that was where we started our tunnel there. I tried to get away. We tried to get away on the train coming up from Rothenburg. We weren't able to do that. We were in one aborted attempt at a tunnel, and one over the fence attempt, which was thwarted because the rain we needed stopped as we got to the outside gate where we were going to climb up over. It was lucky that night we we weren't seen. We had to come down a second story drain pipe to the ground, crawl an open ground over to an inner gate, which had two fences going down to the gate to which they brought the cars in, or the trucks with different stuff that they use. So we had to get over this gate, which we never made. It was in a sort of a hollowed out place. Rain stopped on us, and they started coming out of the little sentry boxes, and the four main towers with machine guns on them, of course, they started throwing the lights around. And we were just lucky we got in and back up and into the second story without getting shot on the walls, but we did it. Finally, the fourth time we tried, we made it. That was when they were trying to move us from this camp back to away from the Russians. And the second night out, my friend and I decided we wouldn't go any further. So that's the same night that our old easygoing guards, because we had them under control pretty well, took off, left us there. So we're on Poland, 1,500 of us in Poland, because we were in various barns along a little road. And so the word was out from our senior American officer, we'll just turn over to the Russians in a group. Well, it sounded great, except at 2 o'clock that afternoon, the Sturmschützer came in. These are the black-shirted people with the white zigzags on. They are mean. They shoot people for fun. We said, we're not going any further than that. So when they marched off, we hid in the hay underneath a beam. And they were pressed for time, so they didn't have time to look for us well. And so they went on and left us there. Then we spent 5 days between the German and Russian lines, which is an unhealthy place to be, because they were still shooting everybody. Had to be careful. And prior to that time, in the September plot plot to kill Hitler, you know, with a bomb under the table.
August of 1944.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And it went off prematurely. From that time on, if you escaped, you were shot. It was a plaque from Heinrich Himmler in every prison camp. If you escape, you will be shot, period. So when we escaped, we had to make sure we made it, because otherwise that's what would happen. They were getting down to the tail end of the war. They were in a perilous position and knew it. So we finally got it. We finally got back to the old prison camp where we had been before. It was ruled by a Russian with a sword about 4 feet long, dragged on the ground while he walked. And we decided we'd continue back toward Warsaw. So we hitchhiked and rode on buckboards and walked all the way to Warsaw. When we got there, we went across the river to Rembertov, which was the old Polish West Point, which is where they were trying to gather us all up. Many camps had been overrun. Some had been left behind because they were ill. And out of our 1,500 officers in that camp, only about 75 of us ever escaped. And but they gathered us all in this one place. After the conference, we were suddenly discovered. In other words, the Russians let our country know where we were. Up to that time, we had planned another move to walk 900 miles to Greece, keeping close enough behind the lines that we would not be questioned too much. And we thought we could do that, getting down there. Of course, by that time, I had amoebic dysentery. I probably died. I had double pneumonia, too. But there wasn't any place to lie down, so we had to keep going. Now, we finally got there, and they sent a train in and took us all the way down to Odessa on the Black Sea, 8 days and 9 nights. Then I turned into the hospital down there. And a German woman doctor who was bragging about her 13 years' experience listened to my chest with a stethoscope about that long with a little room here. Old-fashioned, you know, just exactly like a long time ago, just leaned down. And she said, well, you've got a cold. Then came the laboratory technician. She tested one of my stool samples. She had a rubber football bladder type hat on, a Bunsen burner, and a stamp magnifying glass that folded out. Oh, you've got diarrhea. Thank goodness, because otherwise they wouldn't let me travel, see. But finally, we were on the Morton Bay, HMS Morton Bay, M-O-R-T-O-N, capital B-E-Y, and it had about 1,500 Americans, 1,500 British, and 1,500 French. And so, as we steamed out into the Black Sea from Odessa, the captain on the ship came on speaker system and said, I don't know about you, ladies and gentlemen, but thank God for the United States and Great Britain. So we took off. Then we had a beautiful sight in Istanbul. First time we'd seen any lights on a city in 3 years.
Is that a Russian ship then?
No, HMS, Russian? His Majesty's ship.
His Majesty's, a British
Morton
ship.
Bay, yeah. So that was it, no. The Russians weren't cooperating that much. They didn't have that much stuff to cooperate with. In one place, this guy was standing there patting an American jeep with his hand, which had Russian symbols all over it, say, Ruski jeep, good, stark, stark. Amerikansky jeep, no good. Too late, too light, you know. He didn't even know what the hell he had there, but they were sure that there was a Russian jeep. And if it hadn't been for us, the Russians would have been overrun. They could have been overrun.
So how much time total were you interned from
February 9th, 43 to 44, to January 23rd and 45. That's when we escaped in the winter of 44-45. 23 months in a camp.
At what point were you in R-64 in Poland?
That was where it was, off Lake 64.
That's the one you escaped from?
Yeah, that was in Poland, yeah. The other one in Rothenburg on the Fulda was off Flag, Offizierlager 9AZ. They had different names for it. And then it was the Stalag in Munich and Moosburg. Stalag, I've forgotten what it was. No.
I'd like to ask you a question I asked my grandfather when he was alive.
Why don't we just say that I knew him in camp and he was a great guy because we talked different times and he had much status because of his position as a writer and I think.
He was a Stringer correspondent
That's
for the
right.
Atlanta Journal and yeah. the NBC Network at
That's
that
right,
time.
That's right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
His name was Wright Bryan.
Yeah.
But I asked him once or twice if in R Flag 64 you heard anything about the concentration camps. He said that he heard things and didn't believe them.
You mean the ones for the Jewish people?
Yeah, he said he couldn't believe. They would hear occasional. They didn't hear much.
You know, we didn't hear any really basically until after we got out. And some of the people went to Lublin and some of those other camp areas because that's the way they, that was where they got out or were overrun. And they could not believe what they were seeing, although they knew, of course, that they were watching, seeing something horrible. Two of our people, Lieutenant Colonel Van Vliet and a Captain Smith, both of them graduates of the academy, and they were taken by the Germans to Katyn, K-A-T-Y-N, where all of those Poles had been killed, 12,000 of them. All of the leadership in Poland had been knocked off there by the Russians to enable them to take over Poland without any opposition. The Germans took our two guys there to show them what it was and how they knew it was Russian. Every one of those 12,000 had his hands tied behind him and a hole in the back of his head where he'd been shot up close with a pistol. The Russians did that all the time. The Germans were more inclined prior to that time, the bad ones, to line people up along a trench and shoot them into the trench and then bury them. So, I mean, their ways of doing things were different. And Van Vliet, who is a good friend of mine and still alive in Florida, still has the film that he took there, and he shows on occasion half-hour film of the atrocities at that time. But while we were in camp, we didn't hear much about them, just as Wright said.
You guys must know that.
We kept up with BBC every night, you know.
What sort of machinery did you use for that?
Well, at first, we had some guys build it. I was just junk. Then we got one smuggled in, and we kept it hidden, and every night we'd listen to BBC. Then a fellow that was good at shorthand took that down. Then he would read to three of us. He'd read it out, and we would take it down in longhand. Then we would take the round to the various cabins, barracks, and we would read it to those groups in there and then burn it. So we kept up. We knew where everything was all the time. The Germans put newspapers in, gave us newspapers every day in German. But they were always a day or two behind where we really were.
I've thumbed through the scrapbook of R Flag 64 mm-hmm. that you donated to the Heritage
yeah.
Room.
Yes.
And noticed a sort of newsletter that circulated in the camp.
Called,
is this not information that could go in the newsletter? Or
no,
can
everything.
Can you tell about that?
All flag item, and it was under the it was under the editorship of Frank Diggs, the third that I asked you to give a ring to, and he put this out, and it had just a. I wrote a story, and I wrote a column called "My Day," which was patterned after Eleanor Roosevelt's "My Day" column. That only was humorous, of course, in that respect, and little stuff about plays and play pictures and all that sort of stuff in there. They had a guy on top by the name of Billy. I don't know if it was Druk or not. No. He was a Druk, and he was a printer, Billy something. And so he printed this little item for us and came out once a month. So we have 12 issues of those, which is really a very, very good. I think, as you said, there were some in the book.
Were there things you couldn't print? I'm curious.
No.
You couldn't share that BBC information in that
No, 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 you didn't put any DVC information anywhere. We just knew that. Every night we got caught up on that verbally. But in this item, it was just an interest paper for telling what went on in camp, the shows that were coming up, and making fun of the Germans by drawing a picture of Popeye's goon girl, the goon, you know, with the big nose.
Alice the goon.
And, yeah, he always had two hands and the nose and the eyes over there. Whatever cartoon there was in there, we had some very talented people, literate people in the camp. And whatever there was, there would always be a goon watching over the fence. And the Germans never understood it, of course, obviously. So that just, it's one of those things that as a prisoner of war you do to show that you're superior to your captors. It was really funny, yeah.
It looks like the Kilroy was here.
Yeah, that type of thing. We did, by the way, put on many plays while we were there. The YMCA would bring in this was another thing. Henry, I know his name as well as my own. Henry Soderbergh was the YMCA representative. And boy, what a good guy he was. He came in and he made the Germans do this and that for us, and whether they wanted to or not, he would convince them. And he would bring in stuff like basketballs and so forth. We had a basketball tournament going, softball. There was a little, so everybody could do a little something if they wanted to. Most of the time, I was walking around and around and around the walkway we had there staying in shape to escape. But we also had, we're going to talk about, what he'd bring in, what Henry would bring in. He'd bring in old plays, and we would copy out the parts. We had Three Men on a Horse, You Can't Take It With You, and various other plays, Brother, Orchid. And we put these plays on, those of us who had interest in drama. And they'd play sometimes five and six times a week when they were ready to produce, when we had people who would do the costumes. And we'd have some of the guys dance. We even put on a burlesque show one time with some of the guys dressed up like women. They were just out and out, really, really funny things. And we always had a German, they had two German censors that sat in on every play. But even then, we made fun of them on the stage, and they never knew it, because it was American-type humor, you know, over their heads.
What could you use for a stage?
Well, quite frankly, we had people there who could build anything. They just built a stage. They even had a system where the light, you could dim the lights and put it back again. And, I mean, they just made it out of junk. And the curtains, we got some gunny sacking someplace, they dyed it, and it just worked beautifully.
Can you tell me, in the prison camps, when a new fellow would arrive to the camp, mm-hmm. what would you try to figure out if he was for real?
Oh, yes.
How would you do that?
We had a G2 system, and everybody had to know everybody else, or nobody said anything about what was going on anywhere. In other words, as they came in, if somebody knew them from their other outfit, or could double-check them to know if they were really where they were. We never found any turncoats. The British had one. And he disclosed their tunnel just before it was to break. And they got him after the war, and he served time as a war criminal. But we never found one. We never found one. Thank goodness. I think Americans are kind of hard to go that direction. You'd have to be pretty disaffected to get into something like that. And that was a different age completely till now. I keep forgetting how old 80 is. You know, and I guess Wright was about 80, wasn't he, when he died? And
a little older.
That generation looked at things differently, I think. We went through the Depression and a few trials like that before.
Before you joined up, were you living in Athens, somewhere else?
No, I was living in Moline, Illinois.
Moline, Illinois.
Yes, I went to school at Augustana in Rock Island, Illinois.
Quad cities.
Quad cities, and it's about seven or eight cities just separated by streets. That's all they are. And a little mile, and, you know, and that's next to Rock Island. And Carbon Cliff, that's next to East Moline. And Hampton, and they're all right there together. Called the Quad Cities, that's right. Big John Deere area, which is where I worked my way through college.
Can you tell? about coming home from I believe it was Odessa and the British boat.
Yeah, we got back finally to Port Said, Egypt, where we were. All our clothes were taken off of us and burned, and we were new outfits were outfitted. Finally got back to Naples. And then my guys went ahead and transshipped on ship. But I was in the hospital with a maybe dysentery and pneumonia. So I had to stay another 2 or 3 weeks, because that's a tough treatment for maybe dysentery. You have to stay flat on your back 15 days. And you can't strain at all or you ruin your heart. And so eventually put me on an airplane, C-16, two-engine thing, a real workhorse. I didn't want to get on that sucker. My God, 3 years, 2 years, 3 years overseas. I don't know whether I want to do that or not, you know. But I saw some little wag get on. I said, by God, I guess if a girl can get on, I can. And so then they kicked me off at Casablanca. They did it by who's most important, and second lieutenants were not very important. So I got kicked off at Casablanca with a captain who talked us in our way into a field officer's hotel. Now, we weren't supposed to be there, but then as we were going up to our rooms, down the room came this little kid. Good morning, gentlemen. Good morning. I said, my God, Captain, we've been in this camp too long. That's a 19-year-old full colonel in the Air Force. We couldn't believe it. He and I had been overseas 2 years, and we're still, well, we came in, as you know, I was a second lieutenant, I was 30 years old, and here was this 19-year-old kid, full colonel. Of course, he was a wing commander here. No problem, but we said, boy, times have changed. Well, anyhow, I flew back from there, but I caught a cold on the beach at Casablanca, and I flew with a cold, and I had landed at the Azores. I almost died. You know, it stuffed up in my head, and it came down. He had to come down a few feet at a time. He took about 2 hours to come down, where ordinarily he'd come down like that. The pilot did. I was on oxygen. I just couldn't breathe. And, of course, they had no pressurization in those days, C-54. And we landed there, and I was there 3 weeks, getting over my cold. The doctors won all my cash, so they put me on another plane, sent me to Bermuda. Came through a hell of a storm. I woke up in the air one time. There was such a big drop. I was lying on those bucket seats sideways, curled up. Quite frankly, I woke up, I was in the air. Of course, I hit the floor damn fast, but I mean, that damn thing dropped 900 feet one time. That ship did that boy. I asked some Canadian flyers, what, that was terrible, wasn't it? No, he said, we dropped 3,000 feet one time. I go, oh, whoops. No more of that. Came in New York, and I put down to Washington, D.C. to be debriefed, because, and first thing, oh, in Port Said, it was really good. They said, these guys in plain clothes were walking around us saying, did you know any defectors or
collaborators?
Collaborators. You know any collaborators? What the hell are you talking about? A collaborator, you know? Never occurred to any of us. We didn't know any. There weren't any. Weren't at all. I could have probably been called that as much as anybody, because I went out of the camp 3 times a week, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and did a record show in over the camp loudspeaker system from the Zonderfuhrer's office. And I'd make up funny commercials and put them in, you know, and act just like it was a radio show. And then, of course, every night I practiced doing the news, but they didn't know about that. But there, Zonderfuhrer's office was in an administration building, and I knew who was in every one of the rooms. And I would come back and I'd draw a map for our G2 in the camp so that they would know, in case we had to break that tunnel and try to break out, that we know who was where and when to get them, in case we had to break out. So, but we never had anybody turn coat on us at all, period.
What about mail in there? Did any ever get through?
Yes. Quite a lot got through. Not as much as we'd like, because they were very slow in interpreting it and making sure there wasn't anything in it. But that brings up an interesting story. We were allowed to write one postcard every week and one letter on the fourth week. The letters were about this long, one of those things that fold a postcard usual size. And we usually do very small writing, except the Germans made us write bigger because it was taking them too long to read it and translate it. Then We saved all of our letters, you know, from our wives. My and I did, and everybody did. But later on, when we were getting ready to escape, we had to hollowed out a windowsill in this old building, in an old building, and once again had the two side with the aerospace imagery. We'd hollowed this out, and in between there, right on the windowsill, we had managed to get it out without breaking any bricks or anything, worked it like this and got it loosened. Then there was a place in there we kept our escape food. Now, we had made some escape food, mixed up chocolate, hard chocolate bars, you know, those really hard D bars, and various biscuits, and so hard biscuits, we mixed it up. And we had about 10 pounds of those ready to, for escape purposes. So we made a little knapsack for that. And so we were ready there. But I was going to say, you were asking, what was it that you asked?
I started to ask about mail. And
oh yeah, mail, okay. So when we took the food out, yeah, rather than to try to carry those letters, which were just added poundage, we put our letters from our wives in there. 40 years later, the Poles started to renovate that building and they found the love letters.
Oh my gosh.
And this was all over the pages of the papers. CNN picked it up and put it out all over and got letters from everybody all over everywhere. Because what they did, they told all about the love letters. 40 years later, the love letters were found. The Poles made it sound as if the Germans had not given these letters to us, but they were all geproofed, you know, they'd all been read by the Germans. But they were the ones we got. So my friend and I and our wives were invited to go to the Polish embassy in Washington, have a big party in which they were pointing out the dastardliness of the Germans. Well, unfortunately, I was traveling in Europe and Clemente and I couldn't go. So, but my best friend, they flew him in all the way from Sacramento, California. It was really very interesting.
But you got letters back.
Yeah.
At that time.
Oh, yeah.
Well,
yeah, we got them all back, but you know, made a very good headline. 40 years of love letters. 40 years later.
Well, I can wind this up in a few minutes, but I'd like to ask you one or two more questions.
Mm-hmm.
When did you move to the Athens area? When did you begin WNGC?
1948. I came back and got into radio right away in Davenport, Iowa first, then in Louisville, Kentucky. As each time I came to the end of where I could go up. And I never considered myself a businessman or anything. I was always an actor, or a news person, or an announcer. And we moved from Louisville to Athens, Georgia, because my aunts, all my folks are from the South, except my father who moved north. And my aunts owned a restaurant on the street, right there where the parking lot is for the Trust Company Bank. And so I came down and was going to run a restaurant for them. They had three. And I got in the restaurant business, and people in that day and age who were in the restaurant business were just not high-class people. Steal, cheat, lie. And it just, 2 weeks, I knew I'd made a big mistake. So I told my aunt, you've got to get somebody else. But in the meantime, my wife and family are coming down. I'm staying on with her. WRFC just barely got started, so I went over and I read something on the air for him. And the program director called him and said, when did we get in that transcription? Because it sounded like New York and Chicago, of course. And nobody down here at that time spoke like that much. So in about 18 months, I was working both jobs for about 18 months and getting old very fast. I thought, my God, you know, I was pooped all the time. I thought getting old was that bad. But anyhow, I went ahead as working for WRFC because at that time WGAU had been sitting on a CBS and nobody worried about it at all. And they had never had news like I did it before with full reporting of white and as well as black affairs and plugging for integration, these types of things with editorials, you know. They had never heard anybody like that before. So RFC was a very, very popular station for many, many years because I was there. And then the two guys, I said, in 1952, at the age of 36, I said, well, if I'm ever going to get to the big time, it's a dream of every announcer, I had better do it before I'm 40. So I took my vacation and auditioned, and CBS offered me a job. So now I got to decide, am I going to stay in Athens at $75 a week? go to the big city, 175 or 150, plus residuals on commercials. And I knew I'd get a lot of those. I had full confidence in my talents. But live in an apartment house, take that goddamn subway in and out, you know, and be another hour and a half each way, and bring my kids up in a park. I just don't think so. So I was not going to go, but the two people that owned WRFC at that time thought that I was going to leave. So they offered to let me buy 10%. So I borrowed $3,500 and bought 10% because it wasn't very big then. I made it into what it was. And then they gypped me. So I got mad and bought WGAU with a friend of mine. Bought some more money, and we quadrupled the business the first month we had it. From
what
then
year
on,
was
we went.
That
was in 1956. At the age of 60, I was just thinking. I went into business for myself at 40. At 50, we bought another station. At 60, I borrowed an awful lot of money to go to 100,000 watts with WNGC. At 70, I bought a heck of a lot more than that to go into business with my son so he could take over the company. Bought two stations in California. And so now he's in charge of the company. But he, of course, he was in it some as when he was a kid. He was around at all times, so he understood it. And he made a big success of himself in another field first. And then he decided he could come and help.
And how old is your son, and who are your children or your
I have, starting with the youngest, Randolph Jr. is 30 years old. Wait a minute, he's born in 54, 94. He's 40, 94.
40 years old.
In August, he'll be 40, can't believe it. Marjorie, my third daughter, is about 43. She is taking her PhD in clinical psychology at Georgia State, has our three grandchildren, two girls and a boy. My second daughter is an artist. She has her own business in Tyler, Texas. She does calendars, and she also does, the most important thing is she does stoneware, sells it on a national basis. We even saw some in a shop in Sitka, Alaska one time. So then my firstborn, Janice, is a public relations manager for Arthur Anderson in Dallas, Fort Worth. So they're all doing very, very well. And of course, my wife is the reason that all this happened. Because when you're married to a radio personality, or you have to stand for an awful lot of being gone. I haven't been around at different times, and as a businessman and expanding, I haven't been around when I should have been. She's managed everything. She's a strong, firm hand, does just a great job. Because we're still married after 52 years.
Actually, what you said about the early days of radio here in Athens begs a question for me about race. Mm-hmm. Were there colored soldiers in prison?
No, because in that day and age, all of the black units were quartermaster, and I knew any who got captured. I knew some black aviators who had a wing of their own in the hospital where I was, but I never saw a black prisoner. I saw one black prisoner of war. I heard this cultured English voice in back of me. And I looked around, and there was a black guy about 6 inches tall, obviously a graduate of Oxford or someplace. And I don't know how he got captured, but he was in the prison camp at Mosburg. I remember he was the only black guy I ever saw there. That was a dumb age, you know. It was really dumb.
Well, what... do you think the gentlemen who were in the wing of the hospital, could those have been the Tuskegee Airmen?
No.
Does that ring a bell?
No, I don't think so. In there.
I see. I've been asking people as a last question. If you were speaking to an audience of younger people,
mm-hmm.
summing up for them the World War II era, what would you leave them thinking about? What would you have them remember the most?
I think that the most important thing for them to remember was that their grandfathers gave up a heck of a lot of their lives so that they could continue on being free without being forced by some dictator or other to do what they didn't want to be, have control of their lives. I think it was important that we got in that war. We got into it almost too late, even though I was not an advocate of it before I served in there. I was not an advocate of going over there and fighting somebody else's battles. However, as the world is getting smaller and smaller, and as each generation comes up, it's smaller than that, what happens in Rwanda is of interest, to us. I'd like to say, well, just let them fight it out, and what the heck, because we're overpopulated anyway. But I believe that the most important thing for the youth of today to think about is that these guys saw something that needed to be done, and they went and got it done. They had a purpose in their life. This made many people have a purpose in their life. Those of us who are older, like as I was, I think we already knew what we were trying to do. But what it was to try to do better than what we had been doing, always with the idea of moving up, up, intellectually, physically, and or in position in life. I think we were the Horatio Alger, really, and our father's generation were the Horatio Alger people, starting from nothing, going up. Not many of us had any. There were very, very few rich people in those days. Very few. I knew some, but only I knew them by name. I didn't associate with any. But I think that's that we really have allowed them the wide choice of living in life that they have, quite frankly.
Thank you very much for speaking on the record for us,
Mr. Holder. My pleasure. I'm glad you're doing this because it does take care of people who were there instead of who thought about it maybe or went back and tried to look at it from a long ways away. I don't think you can look at this thing very long ways away. It's quite real for me, and I hope that I can put a lot of this in the book that I'm going to publish before the end of the year.
Have you written the manuscript already?
It's called Escape to Russia, which sounds stupid, but and it may have been, but that was the only way we had to go at that time, the only way we could go. But yes, the manuscript is done. I'll be checking it over in the next few weeks.
We'll purchase a copy.
Well, good, by golly. If this is any good, I might give you one.